Hello, hello. It is so good to be with you here today. Good morning, buongiorno, ciao, guten tag, wherever you are in the world. Welcome, welcome. It is such an honor and a pleasure to be here with you today at the first annual CSM Summit. So thank you so much. Wasn't that fun to watch that again? I think I could watch my race over and over again and say, oh, maybe this day maybe it'll be a little different. Maybe this time something else is going to happen. It's so fun for me to watch and see. I want to dive in. The first thing that I've thought about in sharing our time together today is, what is success and how do we reach it? How do we reach success on any level? So that's what I want to dive into today. That's what I want to share with you. But first of all, I want to go in a little bit as to how I got into this crazy sport of skeleton. Because are you wondering how I got into this sport? It's kind of random, right? So let's take a look at this first image right here. All right. So this is me competing in my first year of, well, this is maybe about 2 years in. I was introduced to this crazy, crazy sport of skeleton when I was 15 years old, believe it or not. I ran track and field. And in track and field, I actually went on to compete in college in 10 events on a full ride scholarship in Utah, the University of Utah, graduated from Utah Valley University. And I competed in high jump, long jump, shot put, javelin, the 100 meter hurdles, the 200, the 800, and I also did hammer, discus, and weight throw. Man, that's a mouthful, right? For those of you that know about track and field, that's actually that's a ton of events to be doing. What I learned first of all when I was 15 years old is that we actually do steer on our sleds. We steer using our shoulders and our knees, opposite shoulder, opposite knee, at different times, going through different corners, going 90 miles an hour. That's about 140 kilometers an hour with our chin less than an inch, about a centimeter off of the ice. And flying down the track, we have to know exactly where we want to go. We have to know exactly how we want to steer every single inch of the way down that track. So I was introduced to this by my track and field coach when I was 15 years old. I actually started doing bobsledding, which is a crazy sport where two or four people get into this little car thing and they actually go down the track and their heads bobble around. That's why they call it bobsled. Like, no joke, that's why they call it bobsledding. And I soon fell in love with skeleton. I grew up in Utah and this was just short of the 2002 Winter Olympic Games. And I was excited and anticipating moving forward with my career in skeleton. I could see like the Olympic Games, all the signs, everything, all the excitement was surrounding me. And I was just looking forward to it. And I made it onto the World Cup team. I missed out on the 2002 games just because I was a rookie. I hadn't had enough experience yet, but I was able to watch my teammates go on to win the gold and the silver in the sport of skeleton. They won the gold and the silver for USA, my country. And I remember it just lit this fire in me. And I questioned myself, what does success look like to me? What would that look like in skeleton? What do I want out of this sport? Well, for myself, I knew I wanted to take it all the way. I wanted to see how far I could go in this sport. So one of the first stories that I want to share with you took place shortly after I started competing. About 2 years after I started competing in skeleton, our team, my World Cup team, I made it onto World Cup, and we were traveling overseas. So I had competed in Park City, Utah. I had competed in Lake Placid, New York, which are my home tracks. I'm close. It's local. They're within my country. Well, now I had been invited to go over and travel to Europe and to try out some of those tracks over there. And I remember feeling this just like weight on my shoulder. Am I good enough? Am I going to be able to achieve the success that I'm hoping to achieve? Am I going to be able to make my coaches proud? Can I make it come together when it counts? I was the youngest one on this team. And as we flew over, we got into the airplane, we flew over to Europe. And I remember landing in Munich, Germany. We had to rent our cars. We got into our vans and drove all the way over to the eastern border of Germany and Czechoslovakia. And I remember as we were driving there, looking up into the sky, and it was all gray clouds. It was dreary. It was raining. And not to mention, so this was already like an ominous sign that something is looming ahead, right? I should have seen that warning. But one by one, my teammates started warning me of the dangers of this track in Altenburg, Germany. Every track in the world is different. Some of them are really easy. Some of them are really hard. This one was beyond difficult. And as we got closer and closer to this track, I remember my teammates talking to me in the car. So first of all, Leanne was saying, okay, Noelle, no matter what you do, you need to make sure that you steer down and then steer up. So I'm steering with my shoulder pressures, right? I'm torquing my sled. That's how we steer the entire way down this track. And she said, you make sure you steer down and steer up in corner four, or else you're going to flip. You're going to flip onto your back, and then you're going to lose your run. And then all of a sudden, Chris is like, no, 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 Noelle, it's not corner four. You want to worry about corner nine. Corner nine, you're going to go up and down and up, and then you're actually going to come up even higher and flip onto your back, and there goes your run. You're done. You're toast, right? And then all of a sudden, Caleb's like, it's not corner four. It's not corner nine. It's corner 10. It's not corner 10. It's corner 12. I was so scared of this track before I even got there. I was so scared, so intimidated by it, just paralyzed with fear. So I remember getting out of the van, getting my sled out of the back of the van, grabbing my bag, my track bag, and walking into this start house. It's just a nice little, a little hut where we get warm, get out of the cold. It's freezing cold, by the way. When we do skeleton, our speed suits are not insulated at all. It's like a girl's swimsuit, like from head to toe. We have a helmet, we have gloves, we have spikes on our feet, that's it. Like no insulation, no padding, no protection. We're trying to be as thin aerodynamic as possible. So I remember going into the start house already shaking. I think, I don't know if it was from the cold or from being super scared to go down the track, but I remember walking into the start house and all the fear overcame me. Okay, don't crash in corner four. Don't crash in corner nine. Don't hit the roof in corner 10. Make sure that you don't get into the ambulance. The first word that I ever learned in German was from my teammate. He came running up to me and he said, oh, Noelle, by the way, I forgot to tell you something. No matter what you do, do not get in the Krankenwagen. True story. That's the first German word I ever learned. Krankenwagen. And I'm sure a lot of you, if I said, maybe type in the chat box. I'm going to just give it to you for a second. Type in the chat box. Who knows what Krankenwagen means in German? Type in there. I know you've got some space in there. All right, I might cut you off before you hit that enter button, but Krankenwagen, I came to find, means ambulance. Nine Krankenwagen. He said, no matter what you do, like, just do not get in the Krankenwagen. They don't have a hospital in this area. They only have a vet. Like, that's the only thing they have in this area. So you'd be treated with the cows and the dogs and the pigs. Don't get in the Krankenwagen. Like, number one rule in Altenburg, don't get in the Krankenwagen. I'm like, okay, I can do this, I can do this. Okay, corner four, corner nine, corner 10, nine Krankenwagen. Okay, 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 I got this. I can do this, I can do this. So I was not only the youngest one on the US World Cup team, I was the youngest athlete on the entire World Cup circuit. I was clearly the rookie of rookies. And I remember as I showed up to the starting line, so I had gotten warmed up, all I could think about is don't crash, don't crash. This is the scariest track ever, super intimidating. And also I get out to the starting line and there's two girls in front of me. Now the first girl, she is a veteran. Like, she's the grandma on the World Cup circuit. No joke. Like, she, that we joke about it. But she had been to this track many, 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 many times. Kilo girl from Japan. Her name is Eiko Nakayama. Domo arigato. Mr. Roboto is how I remember that one. But anyway, Ohayou gozaimasu. So the announcer comes on in German and he says, "Sie Bahn ist frei für Eiko Nakayama." So Eiko sets her, so that means that the track is clear. It means her green light is going off and she has 30 seconds to set her sled down on the ice and take off, run, 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 jump onto her stomach and go down the track. So the announcer comes on, she sets her sled down on the track, she run, 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 she jumps onto her sled and she starts going down the track. She goes past the crest, we can't see her anymore, she goes into corner one. Okay, Noah, come on, you can do this, you can do this, okay. Okay, steer down, steer up, okay, you got this, come on, you got this. I'm just trying to give myself this like pep talk, right? And all of a sudden, I look up at her clock, and it's ticking. Tick, tock, tick, tock, stop. And the announcer comes on, in German again, and he says, Achtung, Achtung, 81, 81 in the track. So 81 means that she's crashed. It means that she's flipped over, her sled's flipped over, they're going down separate times, and all of a sudden, in the distance, you could hear, meow, 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 You could hear the sirens coming, right? And Chris is over there in the distance. He's like, nine, Krankenwagen, do not get in the Krankenwagen. We're like, oh my gosh, Aiko just went off to the ambulance. What's going to happen? She's going to see the vet. Okay, Noelle, you've got this. Corner four, corner nine, corner 12, 10. I think there was a 17 in there somewhere. Okay, I got this. I got this. I got this. Aiko went off to the ambulance. We didn't see her for like 3 days. Like 3 days. I don't even know what they did for 3 days. I don't know why she was there for 3 days. But all of a sudden, the next girl in front of me was up. And this is Deanna Panting from Canada. She was a world champion, like really, really good at this sport. She has been down this track in Altenburg many, many times. So I'm like, it's okay, okay. I got this, Noelle, you got this. Okay, here we go. So Deanna's name is called. Zubanus Fry for Deanna Panting. The green light goes off. She starts running. Okay, so her green light goes off. She takes off, she starts running. Run, 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 run. She dives onto her sled, goes past the crest into corner one. So I can't see her anymore. All of a sudden, within seconds, tick, tock, tick, tock, stop. Octune, Octune, 81, 81 in the track. I'm like, oh my gosh, these guys are like veterans. They've done this like 1,000 times before. I'm a rookie. I've never been here before. They're crashing. They're going off to the ambulance. Come on, come on, Noelle, pull yourself together. So she did. She went off to the ambulance. Pew, 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 takes her off into the Krankenwagen. Nine Krankenwagen. Chris is over there on the side. Nine Krankenwagen. Do not get in the ambulance. I'm like shaking. I am so scared now. I am so scared to go down this track. And I'm sitting there looking, and all of a sudden the announcer comes on. Zibanes Fry for Noelle Pikus Pace. And I'm like, ah, I don't think I want to go. I think I'm just going to sneak off and nobody will notice. But obviously I couldn't. Like everybody knew, like there's my name. My green light went off. So I set my sled down, and instead of like taking off, run, 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 I was like tiptoeing down the track, slowly getting onto my sled, barely lowering myself, dragging both feet into corner one, just hoping to just hold on tight and make it down that track. One curve after another, I rose and fell with the pressure. Corner four, I went into corner four, I went down and up and down. I completely missed the steers that I was supposed to do, flipped over onto my back. My sled is on top of me, and I'm thinking, I've never flipped over before. I've never been in this position before. What am I gonna do? And all of a sudden the next corner went the other way, like it flipped me over the other way. So all of a sudden I'm back on my sled the right way, and I'm like, yes, I'm so good at this sport. This is amazing. So I start going down corner five, corner six, corner seven, corner eight, corner nine. Corner nine, I went down and up and down. I totally forgot what to do. Did the exact same thing, flipped over onto my back, and now I'm like, maybe there's another corner, maybe it's gonna flip me back over, just hold on tight, Noelle. It was the longest straightaway, like it's literally the longest straightaway in the world on a bobsled skeleton track, and I'm flying down on my back with my skeleton sled on top of me, and I could see the coaches from around the world, from Great Britain, from Germany, from Switzerland, from the United States of America, from all countries, and they all had their cameras there, and they're all focusing as I'm flying out of this corner, and they're like, that's not how you do it. Nope, she didn't get that right. So I'm flying down on my back, and all I could do was I kicked the sidewall, and it's hard. It's like concrete. That ice is extremely hard. And I remember kicking away from that sidewall to flip myself back over onto my runners, and I'm thinking, oh, I'm back again. I flipped twice in one run. I've never done even come close to that. So I'm so focused on that crash that I just had, I wasn't even focusing or paying attention on what I needed to do next. So all of a sudden I go flying into this next corner, 360-degree corner. And as I flew into this corner, the G-forces, we reached 5 to 6 G's of pressure, which is a ton of pressure. So my helmet immediately got suctioned down to the ice. All I could see is that white flying by my face. I'm flying into this corner, huge, huge corner. I rose and fell with the pressures up and down and up and down. And I remember coming to that third and final pressure of this massive, massive corner. And I remember I could feel the pressure. I couldn't see where I was going quite yet, but I could feel this weight just getting heavier and heavier on my body. And then as it started to alleviate, started to come off, I remember trying to strain against the weight of that pressure on my neck, forcing my head up to just have a visual, just to see, just a glimpse of where I was headed. And as I pulled my head off of the ice, going probably about 70 to 80 miles an hour at this point, I remember clearly seeing this big wooden piece of wood up at the top of this corner, and I was getting closer and closer to that wood. And as I strained my head against that pressure, I was able to see that wood, and all I could think was, don't hit the wood. Don't hit the wood. What happened? I hit the wood. I hit the wood and I hit it hard. I crashed into the top of the roof, came flying out of that curve, landed luckily in the track with my 65 pound sled. It was like 30 kilos, landed hard on top of my chest and it just knocked the wind out of me. I couldn't breathe. I couldn't breathe. And immediately I tried to push that sled out in front of me because it was on top of me, trying to catch my breath. I could feel my speed suit was getting torn to pieces. I felt like my shoulder blades were on fire, my calves. I flipped over onto my stomach as I'm trying to slow down. I'm still flying down this track, but without my sled. So I'm at the wheel of the course, right? And it's burning through the palms of my gloves. And I could feel my arm slipped out. It hit my elbow. It started bleeding. It's going down the track. And I remember finally coming to a stop, picking myself back up slowly, trying to catch my breath. And in the distance, I could see the paramedics coming and the ambulance. Wee-oo, wee-oo, wee-oo. And all I could say was, Nein Krankenwagen. That's all I could say, Nein Krankenwagen. At least I got something right that day, right? So what does this have to do with success? How do we reach success? This lesson was absolutely critical for my improvement, absolutely critical for my progress. I was going down a track. I was headed towards a goal, right? I had this goal in mind, but I didn't have a sound strategy as to how to achieve that goal. I was rising and falling with the pressures, and ultimately, I was staring at everything that would hold me back. I was staring at my fears. I was staring at my stresses, my anxieties, my worries. I focused on everything I didn't want to have happen. Don't hit the wall. Don't go in early. Don't crash here. Something as simple as shifting my gaze and my focus to where I wanted to go rather than where I didn't want to end up would have made all the difference in the world. What I learned is where you look is where you'll go. Think about that. Where you look is where you'll go. What are you focusing on? Are you focusing on all the things that can hold you back? Are you focused on all of your doubts, all of your insufficiency, all the things that hold you back? Maybe the weaknesses that you have in your life. We all have weaknesses. We all do. Or do you choose to focus on your strengths? Do you choose to shift your gaze and say, you know what? I'm good at this. I'm good at this. I'm good at this. I'm going to make a list. Now let me focus on what I can do. Let me focus on what's in my control. Let me focus on how I can just improve just a little bit today so that I can be better today than I was yesterday. That is absolutely critical to success. So I want to give you a taste of what it looks like to go down a skeleton sled. And while you're watching this short little video to see what it looks like on a skeleton sled, I'm going to share with you what's going on in my mind down the track. Okay, so right here, I'm running about 12 or 13 steps, trying to keep my feet as close to the sled as possible. Remember, try to count how many corners are in this track and put it into the chat box. All right, so right now I'm pushing a little bit of pressure on my left shoulder. I want to keep my eyes about 6 inches to the right, keeping that visual, making sure my feet are together, my toes are pointed, my arms are in nice and tight, and my head is nice and low. I'm putting pressure on my right shoulder right here, making sure I'm 5 inches to the right, right shoulder, left shoulder. Now I'm getting a little bit more speed. Left shoulder, right shoulder, countering, make sure I get in nice and early to that corner, right shoulder, left shoulder, right shoulder, getting into my knee steers. Right here, we crash a lot actually. Left knee, right shoulder. Now I want to make sure I get in nice and centered to this corner. People come out way too early and they'll actually crash here. So I'm going to come in right shoulder, left shoulder. Right here, we actually get negative G forces. We come flying off of our sled. It's easy to crash. Right shoulder, left shoulder, right shoulder, left shoulder. Counter with my left toe because I want to stay off of that right wall. I'm going to stare about 4 inches to the right on this corner. Left knee, right knee, right knee. Wait. Pause. Left knee. People crash here all the time. Bobsleds flip all the time. It's really brutal. Left knee, right knee, right knee, left knee. Now I'm going to push out. Now I'm going to counter with my left shoulder. Oh my goodness, I'm getting tongue-tied. Right shoulder, left knee. And now I'm going to stretch my neck forth to try and get to that finish line just even a tiny bit faster. And we don't have brakes. Like, how crazy is that? We don't have brakes. That could be the scariest part about our whole trip, isn't slowing down at the end. Man, I can't even speak. Like, a hundredth of what goes on in my mind and what my body is doing down the track. I can't even tell you even a hundredth of what's going on. So just put into the chat box, How many corners, how many curves do you think there were in that track? And I didn't want to share with you which track that was, because then you might be like, you know, going on to Google or searching or something to find out what it was. And I'll tell you in a second. But make sure, I'm just going to give you just a second to go in and type out how many corners do you think are in that track. All right, so skeleton is just like goal setting. All right, we talk about customer success. How do you reach success? How do you reach that ultimate goal? How do you reach that ultimate finish line? How do you do it? Do you just hold on tight and hope that it will happen? Or is there a better way? Within skeleton, as you were able to watch that video, I like to think of skeleton as a puzzle. I like to think of anything that we do as a puzzle, the learning around us, anything that we're diving into, sales. It's a puzzle. It's figuring out what works, what doesn't work, and how can I improve? Which pieces can I connect together to become just a little bit better, make this picture just a little clearer, right? Awesome. Thanks for typing in your comments. And I'm going to tell you right now, okay, so there's 19 corners. So if you said anywhere between like 17, 18, 19, 20, somewhere in there, I would have given it to you. There's actually a section in this track. This is Lake Placid, New York, one of my absolute favorite tracks in the entire world. And one of the parts in the track, it's actually, it looks like a straightaway, but it's called a chicane. And what that means is they actually raise up the ice on one side and raise it up on the other, so you're actually going through there kind of like a little water slide. So that actually counts as two corners. So anything between like 17 to 20, I would have been like, yes! Hired. Yes, come out and try it. Come out to Utah, you guys. Man, it's beautiful weather. Come out and try skeleton. There you go. There's my recruitment. Awesome. So skeleton, just like putting together a puzzle. I want to share with you another lesson, a very, very critical lesson in my life and along my career. Happened shortly after this crash in Altenburg. So I recognized that I needed a plan. I recognized that I needed to focus on where I wanted to go rather than where I didn't want to end up. I realized that I needed to put that puzzle together to figure out what success looked like for myself. After this happened, after realizing, what does success look like to me? And think about that for yourselves. I'd love for you to write that question down and consider it throughout the day. What does success look like to me? What does that mean within my career? What does that mean within what I'm doing day in, day out? What is success? If we don't know what success looks like to ourselves, how will we know when we reach it? So shortly after this happened in Altenburg, Germany, I started writing goals for myself each and every day, staying focused on where I wanted to go rather than where I didn't want to end up. And within 3 years of starting this crazy sport, I became the first American woman to win the overall World Cup title. So that means I was ranked first in the world in the sport of skeleton. Woohoo! Yay! Awesome. Yeah. So it's super cool, super fun, super exciting. And I was just, you know, months away from going to the Olympic Games in Torino, Italy. As I prepared for our Olympic trials, I still had to try out for the U.S. Olympic team. I was ready to go. Mentally, I was at the top of my game. Physically, I felt extremely fit and ready to go, ready to show my stuff. I still had to try out. And as I finished going down a practice run at our Olympic trials, one by one, my teammates came down beside me. And we're sitting there waiting for a truck, a flatbed truck, to come down and meet us at the bottom of the track, and it would back up. We would climb up some stairs and take our sleds and go into this flatbed truck, sit down, and the truck would take us back up to the top of the track so that we could slide down again. As we were sitting there waiting for this truck to come, and we were talking about our run, I still remember clearly the sound that I heard that day. I remember a loud rumbling noise echoing all around me. And I turned to look towards the finish line to see where this noise was coming from, about 100 meters away. And there was a 4-man bobsled flying towards us at about 70 miles an hour. And immediately we saw this bobsled coming towards us, and we all jumped to our feet, four of my teammates and myself. We jumped to our feet to get out of the way of this oncoming bobsled that we did not expect to come down the track at that time. And right when we jumped up to our feet to get out of the way, my teammates were in front of me. So I was at the back of the pack, and the staircase was behind me, so I couldn't just jump out the back. I had to take a step with my right foot. I took a step with my right foot to jump out of the way of this staircase. And right as I took that step, right as I planted my foot in the ice, the bobsled hit me from behind. And I remember flying through the air. I did a complete flip, a flip and a half, I think. And I landed 25 or 30 feet away from where I had just been positioned. Immediately, I tried to jump up to my feet to see what had just happened. And I fell back to the ground. I could see my teammates were screaming and just running around. It was chaos and commotion. And I could see that this bobsled had flown out of the end of the track, and my sled was actually stuck underneath this bobsled. And I tried to jump up to my feet again to run over there to say, what just happened? How did I end up all the way over here? And I fell back to the ground. And at that moment, I looked down at my legs to see, why can't I just run over there? Why can't I be with my teammates? Why can't I figure this out? And when I looked down at my right leg, I could see my bones were sticking out. My right heel was touching my calf. In a split second, my life changed. I was ranked first in the world, and the Torino Olympics were just 3 months away. I had the yellow jersey on. I was the one that everybody was trying to reach. And in a split second, everything changed. I remember going to the hospital after having a titanium rod. I have a rod. I still have it in my leg. A titanium rod was inserted through my leg from my knee to my ankle, had some screws put in the side. And I remember after I came out of surgery, sitting in my hospital room, and that was the moment that it hit me, that my Olympic dream was gone. Tomorrow morning, my teammates are going to go on to compete, to train, to go on for this Olympic spot. And I will still be sitting here in this hospital room with these staples all up and down my leg. Everything, the sacrifice, the time, the money, the time away from my, I've been married for about 2 years at that point, the time away from my husband. All that sacrifice. I had a tear that started coming down my cheeks. And I remember sitting there in this hospital room crying when that hospital door flew open. My doctor walked in, Dr. Mrkonjic walked in with her clipboard in her hand. She looked up from this clipboard and she saw these tears coming down my face. And she said, "Why are you crying? You have two choices. You can either look back and be upset and frustrated and angry at what just happened to you, or you can choose to move forward. Your leg is broken and crying's not going to fix it." I've always realized that I have my agency, that I have my ability to choose. But until I had reached the pit, until I had hit rock bottom, I had no idea fully what that meant. I had no idea that I still had a choice to make. Yes, like I had this visual, like I knew what I needed to do to go to the Olympic Games. That morning that I woke up that morning, I knew exactly. Step one, I need to qualify for the Olympics. Step two, I need to go on to the World Cup. Step three, I need to make this many rankings in this spot. And then it'll take me to the Olympic Games in Torino, Italy. I had a clear-cut path and a visual as to how to get there. And all of a sudden, there was this huge, huge deviation in my life. This huge obstacle, this huge challenge in my life. Getting hit by a bobsled was not on my plan, right? And now I had to figure out, do I give up? Do I throw my hands in the air and say, well, I did my best? Or do I choose to get back on the path that will lead me to the success that I have defined for myself? You always have a choice. Do not blame your circumstances or allow the obstacles and trials in your life to hold you back from becoming who you can become. Use that friction to propel you forward. In skeleton, we have friction all around us. It's a matter of how we choose to use it that can either hold us back or push us forward. We always have a choice. One other lesson that I'd like to share with you before our time is up today. How do you become an Olympian, right? How do you do it? How do you put it all together? To be honest, being an Olympian, becoming an Olympian, is actually really easy to do. I know, that's, I can say that, right? Because I'm an Olympian, so it's like, oh, she can say that because she knows, right? Like, I know, it's really easy to do. If you don't see it as this four-year goal, if you don't even see it as a year-long goal, if you can break it down into the smallest of pieces, I can wake up and get a workout in and give my absolute best. I can learn from my mistakes. Then guess what? Once you put that together, it becomes easy to improve each and every day. My coach had a saying throughout our entire, the final 2 years leading up to the Olympic Games in the 2014 Sochi Winter Olympic Games, he had this saying, this mantra that he used with our team. And I highly recommend to maybe grab a piece of paper, put it on your device, wherever it is. But here it is. It is imperative that we are process-oriented and results-driven. I'm going to say it one more time. It is imperative that we are process-oriented and results-driven. If you're always focused on the sales numbers, if you're always focused on the mark, hitting that podium, if you're always focused on the ranking and the standings and that end goal, you're going to miss the whole purpose of it. That's not how you get there. Yes, have that dream, have that goal, and then shelf it. Put it up there so that you can see it clearly and you know where you're aiming for, but then bring it back to today. Bring it back to what can I improve upon today and how am I going to get here? I love this concept, the 1% better rule. All right? The 1% better rule is simply this. Number one, learn from the past. Number two, be excited about the future. And number three, give your absolute best in the present. Becoming an Olympian is easy. Reaching success in our lives is easy. Does that mean we're not going to fail? No, no. Success is built upon a whole pile of failures, a huge, huge pile of them, right? Mistakes and setbacks and obstacles. There's many, many more of those than there are or ever will be of success. But if we have that clear vision and we continue to push through those obstacles, if we recognize that we always have a choice to make and climb those mountains as they come, success is within our grasp. Be 1% better today than you were yesterday. Learn from the past. Every single day I had a journal. I would write down in my journal three goals that I had for myself. Every single day, it's that simple. Three goals, all right? Very specific goals. But then at the end of the day, I would reflect. Take time to reflect. Take time to meditate. Whatever you want to call it, take time to think about how you did, how you're doing, and how you want to do in the future. Take time to reflect. Be excited and hopeful about the future. And never settle for anything less than your best. So I'm going to ask you this question. Where is your focus? How will you be 1% better today than you were yesterday? What are you focusing on? Do you set goals for yourself each and every day? Are they realistic? Simplify it. Break it down into the smallest little pieces. Ask others to join you. Design your environment, the things around you, so that it's easier and more attainable to reach those goals. Make it as simple as possible. Remember, learn from your mistakes. Reflect on it. So I challenge you right now to just take a second to write down a goal for yourself. How will you be 1% better today than you were yesterday? And I'm going to pause here for just like 20 seconds and just take a second to think about that. How will you be better today than you were yesterday? All right, hopefully you had just a second to think about it. And if not, I would love for you, I challenge you to continue to think about that. Improve just 1% each and every day. Finally, just in conclusion, as I stood there at that line in 2014, the 2014 Winter Olympic Games, thinking of all the challenges, all the failures, all the mistakes that I had ever made, all the success, all the joy that had brought me to that position, standing there in front of millions, in front of cameras, in front of my family, in front of my friends, in front of my community. As I stood there at that line, I knew going down that track, it was never just about me. It never was. I was the one in front of the camera. I mean, you know, you'd see me going down the track and you saw me jumping up and down, but there was a whole team behind me, a whole team with me throughout that journey. As I stood at that line and thought about my three goals that I wanted to focus on for that day, I remember setting my sled down on the ice with a heart full of gratitude for each and every person that had ever supported me, that had ever cheered me on, that had written me a note. A whole elementary school had written me all these cute little cards just before I had flown out to Russia. And that was all being carried with me that day. I went in and out of those corners. I remember even coming out of corner five, Sochi, Russia, on that video that you saw right before I came out here. Coming out of corner five, I hit the right wall. You may not have noticed it, but I do. I knew then. And I remember clearly thinking that might be it. In skeleton, that's what it comes down to. I had finished fourth place in the 2010 games. Fourth place. So after I missed the Olympics in 2006, I worked really hard, had a baby in between, went on to the 2010 games, finished fourth place. The worst place you can ever finish in an Olympic Games. Gold, silver, bronze, nothing. And as I came out of corner five in Sochi, Russia, 4 years after that point, hitting that right wall, I thought, I got to be good. Like, I got to clear it up, right? I've got to be aerodynamic. I'm not taking fourth place again. And I lowered my head down, got aerodynamic into corner 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, coming down 10, 11, 12, going across the finish line, stretching out my neck, lifting myself up off my sled just to see any sign. How did I do? How did it go? I have no idea. I remember coming up the crest, slowing down, dragging my feet. And the first sign that I had was my coach. He walked out onto the track. He threw his arms in the air. And that was it. I knew. In that moment, I knew it was enough. I didn't know if it was gold. I didn't know if it was silver. I didn't know if it was bronze. And to be honest, I didn't care. I had given it my absolute best. There wasn't 1 ounce left that I had to give. I'd given 100%. And it was enough that day. I remember jumping off my sled. I couldn't get off fast enough. I jumped into my coach's arms, gave him a huge hug. And immediately, the volunteers from Russia were like, you need to go this way. You need to go do your interviews over here, over here. And I said, no. I need to be up there with my family. I need to be up there with them. And I jumped off the track. I took off my helmet. I started screaming. I was looking for a way to get up to my family. The stands were packed full of cameramen and people and spectators. And I couldn't get up to my family. They were up on the front row, high up in the stands. And I remember just thinking, how am I going to do this? How am I going to get up there? I jumped off the stands. And the only thought I had was just go up, and over. So with all the energy I could muster, every ounce of my body was shaking from excitement, from exhilaration. I've never felt that before, from head to toe. And I remember just leaping up into the stands, grabbing onto that bar and using any energy I had left, climbing over that railing and into the arms of my family. As I embraced my husband and two kids, we had two kids now at this point. I took 2 years off between the 2010 games and 2014 games. We had our little boy, Trayson, and I remember jumping into their arms and embracing them. And all I could shout was, we did it. We did it. So what does success look like to you? What is it? How will you know when you get there? Do you recognize the fears and the doubts that surround you? Are you focused on where you want to go? Do you recognize that something as simple as waking up in the morning and setting a couple goals for your day can determine your whole day? Are you going through a routine of doing the same thing day after day after day after day, month after month after year, and you're thinking, what am I doing? Or are you willing to take that leap of faith, starting a new career? Many of you have started new careers. Many of you are diving into this as a new adventure. Where you look is where you'll go. You always have a choice. The choice is yours. Don't leave it to chance. Regardless of the obstacles around you, you always have a choice. And remember that as a team, you'll always go farther when we do it together. Thank you so much for your time. I hope you enjoy the rest of your day. Good luck. Get out there. High fives all around. And thanks so much. See you later.
In the sleepy suburbs of Salt Lake City, Noelle Pikus Pace has an unlikely training program for a world-class athlete. But there is some running.
This run. Cold.
Lifting weights.
You're getting heavy. Who needs weight training when you have kids?
And an adherence to a strict diet.
Are you full? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm just a couple of bites.
I wake up, I get dressed, I get the kids ready, get them dressed. I'll take Lacey to preschool, and then I have a two-hour window where I have to get my workout in, and that's really not that much time at all.
I'll be back, bud.
And when I lift, when I run, my kids are right by my side. I take them to the track, and they're running around. I have to sometimes stop in the middle of the workout to take care of a crying baby or somebody's poopy, but it's great. I love it.
When Pikus Pace first became a mother 6 years ago, skeleton often came before family. But after she finished fourth at the Vancouver Olympics.
Oh, man. So close, a tenth of a second, you know?
She decided the pursuit of gold wasn't worth the sacrifice.
I actually retired the day after the Olympics in 2010. I was done with traveling and being away from them for 5 to 6 months at a time, and we wanted to have more kids.
Where's your coat?
Trayson was born March 23rd, 2011. That was one of the most incredible experiences of my life.
That's the peppers. You do the peppers.
Mama. Nice work, sweetie. In April of 2012, I got pregnant with a third. We found out that we were going to have a little girl. We were thinking of names and everything. I actually had a miscarriage. That was at 18 weeks. Being told that your baby's heart just stopped and you don't know why, nobody knew why. They couldn't tell me. They didn't have an answer. It was really hard. Coming back to skeleton was definitely in response to having a miscarriage. It gave me something to move towards. We've been traveling as a family, and that's really the only way that I would come back to compete is if we could do this as a family.
Holy dynamite, that is fast.
She's back, baby.
She is flying.
It's the best feeling to have them up at the top of the track as that green light goes off. Sometimes I just hear, Mama, 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 and they're crying. And I'm like, okay, focus. I'll see them in 60 seconds.
Noelle Pikus Pace and her family have enjoyed the success. They've endured the injury. They swallowed the retirement and rallied in the comeback. But the wait for an Olympic medal has been far too long. Now is her time. Farewell games, farewell drives, farewell runs are always special. This is it for Noelle Pikus Pace.
Did you see that moment? That moment of prayer there. She closed her eyes and had her last focused anticipation of what she wants out of this run.
In 2005, she won the World Cup. She was then hit in a training accident by a four-man bobsled. 9 weeks later, she came back, but she missed the Torino Games. She had to wait another 4 years for Vancouver and missed the podium by a tenth of a second. She's had to wait to now. This is her final Olympic run for that elusive medal.
All of these turns, what she's carrying with her is her family. The only reason that she is here today because her and Jansen, who built her sled, that's her husband, decided that they wanted to give this one more go as a family together.
Noelle Pikus Pace has that Olympic medal.
Her medal.
She finally has it.
Yeah.
Nice job.
We did it. We did it.
Nice job.